And so it is being recorded, and it'll be posted to the Gas Association's YouTube channel when this webinar is over. If any of you are interested in seeing John's slide deck or in having access to his slide direct deck, ask him directly. I've put his email address down there for you. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing and turn control over to John and his team. And hi, John, there you are.
Morning or good afternoon.
And we are recording, and I think you've got the capability now to pick up the screen and go with it. And there you are.
There we go. We start with a familiar logo. Nice to have the logo on there. About 8 months ago, I was in Dallas at my daughter's college. She's going to SMU. And I met one of the other dads at a place called the Truck Yard, which is where you go and drink lots of beer in Dallas. And they have trucks that come around, food trucks that come around, and you go buy food. And I'd met this gentleman before, Conrad. We had talked a couple of years before at a parents' weekend. So we're talking, and he asked me some things. I asked him, we're up in a little treehouse above the truck yard. And I said, so Conrad, what do you do? And he said, well, I'm sort of in investments. I do investments. I go, do you invest or do you help people invest or do you get investments? What do you do? And he goes, well, I sort of do both. And he went on for a while and I was totally confused. Like, so what type of things do you do? And he was just really not very clear. And I finally said, so Conrad, what industry are you in? And he said, well, I'm in the oil and gas industry. And I said, oh, well, why didn't you just tell me? He goes, because, you know, you're from the West Coast, you're from California. I sort of like you. I didn't want to get in a debate with you about fossil fuels. And that day sort of caught me off guard, because here's someone that sort of knew me. Here's someone that had a pretty good understanding of what my values were, because we had talked once before at a dinner. And he was not proud to share what he's doing. So today, what I want to do is I want to get into the art of listening and the science of messaging. And so we don't have a lot of time, so I'm not going to get really, really deep, but we really need to reexamine how we communicate. Because thinking about Conrad, how did he listen to who I was? If he had, he would have known that I'm a friend and I'm someone who could have talked about. But the best thing that happened with Conrad is he said to me, he goes, we need to have a better way of communicating in fossil fuels. And I'm thinking, well, yeah, I was speaking at the North American Gas Forum about a month later, and I decided I was going to start working on something talking about the science of messaging, how to really cut through with an authentic message. And my slide doesn't want to go forward, but I'll take care of that. That's not going to be a permanent thing because I have a helper here. Okay, so what I want to start with is looking at today's realities. Is we're dealing with a bunch of things going on, and they only have gotten worse during COVID. And so every day we see about 5,000 ads online, even some in papers and some other places. But the most interesting statistic that I've seen is that nearly 2/3 of us who are on the internet on a regular basis are getting our breaking news, a lot of our news, but mostly our breaking news from social media. So what's happening, it's no longer just enough to consume the news. We're trying to learn how to frame, form, and hold opinions at lightning speeds across this breadth of information that we're getting. And that's created a lot of anxiety and fear. So we've become a very nervous nation. And this is before COVID. I can't imagine what the numbers would be like right now. But anxiety has always been a really uncomfortable fact, as this says. But today, it's really grown. So 6 months, a year ago, was 1 in 5 believe they have an anxiety disorder. Think about what that would be today. And then you're looking at teens and college students. They have so much anxiety that it's being diagnosed that they have more anxiety than people that were in mental institutions in the 40s and 50s. So we're facing this, not only what we have now, but a growing amount of anxiety. And then we have the information overload. I mean, how much information we get every day, how much goes through. We're expected to really engage in these complex conversations about conflicting issues. And it's getting really harder and harder to do so. The volume of content increases, and then we're pushed to condense it down to something very simple, something like a perfect, neat, 5-second, 280-character package. And, you know, it's being called the plague of our modern society. If you haven't read Medium stuff, it's a good source to look at some of these things. Then we're into the digital addiction. There's so many people. I mean, this is a pretty typical family. We all fight not to do that. We don't want our whole family, but that really comes out to what it is. My two daughters, one in college and one in law school, I've been home since mid-March. And, you know, just how the days go, we all talk about putting our devices away and having time to really just chat. But we have this addiction to the digital devices. And if you think about it, when the BlackBerry first came out, people started calling it the CrackBerry. And that's really what it is. It's really something we're addicted to. People get it. And I'm going to talk about dopamine in a bit. And that's what really sets it off. It sets you off with dopamine, a hormone that makes you look at things. So the other reality today is we have this moral tribalism. We live in a more polarized world. We look at things, we search sites, and what happens, we get this bias confirmation. We're constantly getting bias confirmation. If we look at one thing on the internet, one place, we're going to get more of it, and we're getting more to confirm what we're doing. So we're constantly confirming our bias. We're always getting something that does that. That takes us and pushes us in corners. So it's not just being a member of one side. Now you're on one side and it sparks emotions at any of the other side and they can't have anything. Think about how that's being played with branding today, with folks like Nike using Colin Kaepernick to be able to do things. So it's changing everything. And you know, the public hates it. We all hate it, but we all do it. We're all really critical of it. We point the finger at the politicians, but we're all doing it. So the reality of this is that the dopamine, so when we see something that makes us jump, something interesting, we get a text, we're gonna do one of four things. We're gonna fight, we're gonna flight, we're gonna freeze, or we're gonna appease. So these are the people that we're trying to talk to. We're trying to tell them that natural gas is good, that what we're doing is important, have a relationship. And they're living in the state of overload and panic, and they're looking to fight, flight, freeze, or appease and take off. And so one of the things that is brought to me in the last few months is how we are listening. And so I thought just a few minutes that we talk about the art of listening. So if I could see a show of hands right now, I think I'd have 100% of you raising your hands if you have ever been instructed in listening, if you've ever been to a class or a self-help place, there's some place, some program to learn how to listen better. And if I asked you, you've been multiple times, probably most of you keep your hands up. So my quick idea here I want to share are some things that I've been researching for the last year. And it's not a self-help course. It's something different. It's listening in a different way. So when our kids were little, we had some friends, my wife's best friend in high school, and we'd help with the kids and everything. And so they pick up our kids, they take our kids, we do the same. One day I got the call, which I never got, to pick up one of our friend's daughters at the zoo camp. And you know, her mom was busy with a sick kid. My wife was off with our kids. So I shoot out of my office. I got like a quarter, half mile to get down to where the zoo is, where we live. And I get in line, my name's on the list. They put Christina in the car. Christina gets in the back seat. She's so excited, you know, someone different. Uncle John, what are you doing here? Well, you know, your mom's home sick with Luke, he's sick. So I'm just gonna drop you off at home. What do you think of that? Christina, she, that's great. We're driving along and just getting on the freeway, drive for about a 15-minute drive. And Christina says, hey, Uncle John, what's virgin mean? What's virgin mean? And I'm like, oh, I don't want to have this conversation with an 8-9-year-old daughter of a friend. I don't want to have this conversation at all, period. So I changed subject. I say, so what did you see today at the zoo camp? What did you see, any animals? Did you help anything? Do you feed anyone? yeah, we got to feed these and this, and we did this. But Uncle John, what's virgin? What does that mean? And being a communications expert, I asked every question, right? You answer a question with asking a question. I said, so Christina, can you, I'm not sure if I understand, can you like help me a little bit? And she said, you know, virgin. I said, well, it means, you know, clean, untouched. She goes, no, Uncle John, that's not it. I go, can you use it in a sentence? She said, yeah, you know, the Disney version of Pinocchio. I'm like, oh my gosh. I was hearing, but I wasn't listening. And I think we all do that a lot, that we hear, but we don't listen. So I want to look at just a little bit of this and thinking about where we are today in our world, that we have this civil discourse that is dangerously shrinking. And I think it's imperative for all of us to get better, or we're going to have a lot bigger issues than just the acceptance in natural gas or the elections in November. And I think maybe this statement is maybe a portion of the shrinkage of civic discourse is how we've been taught to listen. You know, as an industry under attack, I think it's important for us to listen in a new way, a way that steps out of the self-help paradigm, to look at things a little differently. And because listening has to be an act of humility. And it's not the physical act of hearing, it's the emotional, mental act of listening. And when we do so, it makes everything different. So humility means that we listen to benefit what's going on. And we're not there just to power through it. We're not there without humility. We don't have a right to evaluate, to judge, or to control. I mean, think about how hard that is for all of us. That's really hard. So I want to look at four means to implement this, a really quick look. And we'll jump to these quickly. So first is for listening humility is to give up control. To do so, we must relinquish the dominance. And that may seem like a really weak thing to do. It's really unsettling, especially when we're dealing with people that want to put us out of business or want to municipalize us. And it's a noticeable failure to defend our boundaries. That feels like a failure, that we're not defending our boundaries, or we capitulate on something that we concludes our values in some way. It's vulnerable and it feels very dangerous. But the minute we give up control, we open people up to talk to us. So we need to start by doing that. And then next, very simply, is we have to acknowledge the other's perspective. And we do that with a humility and acknowledging that others have a perspective that is totally valid. And because we'll never build a relationship if we don't understand that they have a totally valid relationship with their truth, their facts, and then we need to deal with it. And then we need to recognize the other's worth. And if you think about now, if we could get those we have to debate with or those that we're trying to work with in a community to do these things, it would be amazing, right? So we're not just acknowledging another's perspective, but we're recognizing their worth and their dignity. And that's a game changer. That really changes things. And in essence, that's a really authentic relationship. That's an authentic engagement. And we're able to really deal with that. That leads to the most important element, which is intellectual humility. This is being humble. This is having humility to be surprised and to learn from others. Once we give this away, we can learn some things. And we learn some things, I mean, we're shocked that how close we are in a lot of things. But if we come into it with only our point of view, when we're not listening, we never learn that. And then last is something none of us get to do anymore. We leave time to reflect. And think about that. That's like having this, to me, it's like this silence is deafening. Having time, total silence, having a moment to look at people, to think about something, really look at the person non-verbally, really even ask some more questions and digging in. And then we're able to really understand that's a really authentic engagement. Okay, I could go into this for a long time. I jumped through it, stumbled through some things because I'm trying to be short. So this listening with humility is a hopeful action. It encourages growth and greater accord. It will grow civic discourse, and it takes two, but it starts with one. It has to start with someone to model it, and that should be us in the debate that's happening today. I think as we're seeing what's happening in the world, that things are getting changed, things are getting canceled, decisions are being made in a snap of the finger. And we're in an industry that there's some people who would like to snap their finger and have us disappear. And I think we need to learn how to deal with that. So if we want civic discourse to grow and not shrink, we have to leave our ego home. We have to give up control. And usually we didn't have that control anyway. We need to acknowledge others. We got to recognize others as valuable and they have valuable ideas, and then stop to really take it all in and reflect. If we can do that, it's a game changer. It's a total game changer. Okay, enough of listening. Let's talk about how we can use the science of messaging. I think we all have been watching, and in the past, we believe decisions were all based upon intuition, our personal experiences, anecdotes of what was going on. And what's happening is we now have evidence-based decision-making. And that's dominating business decisions, investment decisions, government, national defense, and even sports. You think about Moneyball, what that's done and what's happening in sports with that. So today we prize big data and we celebrate behavioral scientists and all that work. Well, at the same time, social psychological research, which has been going on for a long time, and people have been talking about it a long time, and some things they're going to show you are not brand new, but the things have been going on. They finally earned respect because evidence-based decision-making in other areas has. Why wouldn't it be in research about relationships? So I'm going to try to share some highlights of how that impacts the perception of the gas industry. So let's take a look through these. We're going to talk about five things. The first one is the power of connection, and we'll unpack these. The second is the power of credibility. The third one is the power of others. Fourth is the power of medium. And fifth is the power of attention. So look at the power of connection. So the connection that we can make and the relationships not only intensify our willingness to help, it also creates a willingness to join and help. Other people join in helping. So it's a pretty big deal. And if you look at the internet now, it allows networked movements to grow dramatically and rapidly without building a formal organization, without having a lot of history. And by deploying digital tools to mobilize, movements can avoid many of the aspects, costly aspects of political organizing. It's a very cool thing. And I'm gonna talk about one experience from Egypt. But the ability to organize with other organizations may speed things up, but it misses a key ingredient. For long-term continued success, we need to make a connection. And so the best study I can share with this is in 2009 when the Tea Party first started. So Tax Day, April 15th, 2009, that's the day they introduced the Tea Party and things got going. So some protest locations were beautiful sunny days, and then others around the country happened to have some rainy days. And researchers over time compared the areas where the Tea Party protests started, and they could be held because it was a nice sunny day, and then places where it was rained out. And, you know, that's a pretty natural occurring experience. It's weather can't be done anything but random. So we're able to look at it. So comparing the rainy locations with the places where the sun was out those days, they showed that holding a protest and having people show up had with a higher turnout made a bigger change in the outcome of what the Tea Party wanted. So the Republican Party, the Tea Party's chosen party, in the future elections that came, had a larger turnout of voters. In those districts, many of the Democratic candidates, because the Tea Party's that organized in those places where they could meet, were louder and chased some other party representatives out of running for office. They retired. And they made a lot more policy changes in local government. But the other thing is there was more grassroots organizing. they had more protest, they had larger monetary contributions, and created a stronger belief system of people fighting it. So that's pretty crazy that that happens. So when you look at that, you think, okay, so the people in the non-raining cities met one another at the protest that could be held and continued to organize, and they had relationships and they continued to play because they met. So, you know, we talked about dopamine a minute ago. One hormone catches our attention, probably driving us all to anxiety and overload. There's another one that is also involved here, oxytocin. It connects us to other people. It makes us feel what others feel. It makes us think about other people. And it makes us really get together. So when we take these two together, we understand why people do what they do. We understand what happens when people connect, and we utilize it to make lasting relationships. So one of the really tough things happening right now with all of us locked down and people not meeting and not doing stuff is we're not making those connections. So with our two companies, the two staffs, we try to have a lot of meetings. With one company, that it's, we have a lot of young folks right out of college, the natural for that firm. And we have a Monday, Wednesday, Friday, half hour Zoom meeting. And it's a no topic, no agenda, we just chat meeting. And they've been phenomenal. And we've been doing it since the first week. And it's that connection. And we're making connections that I don't think we would have made in the office that have been pretty crazy good. This also leads to one of the keys of our philosophy is to cultivate relationships and with people who say they're your supporters, people, thought leaders, people who are with you. You've got to cultivate supporters to become advocates so then they can share your story. And we do that by getting together with them, bringing them together at an event, bringing them together, because this is what's happening in our society. You create some belonging, because anxiety and loneliness has really created a society that is parched for genuine community. Think what's going to happen after this. I think we're going to have some serious, interesting issues as this ends. So number one, there's an amazing power connection in messaging and how we work with people. So we need to capture that. The second one is a power of credibility. And the general idea here is that how do we earn credibility in a time when we don't have a lot of time to earn credibility? No matter what happens, people are making fast decisions. So we earn credibility and illustrate our integrity by admitting upfront to a drawback before we highlight our strength. And how much don't any of us do that? And so this is one of my favorite people. I found this story and then I started reading up on the history, and I just found Elizabeth, Queen Elizabeth I. So 1588. So she did both of these things, trying to optimize an impact, and in two of her incredibly celebrated speeches. So this first speech in 1588 was when she was addressing her troops. They were massing against an expected sea invasion from Spain. She dispelled the soldiers' concern that as a woman, she was not up to the rigors of battle. And it was reported for those on the site that the leaders in the military there had to calm the people down there, applauding and cheering and so happy. And she said, "I know I have the body of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart of a king and a king of England too." I mean, first off, that wouldn't go over really well now. So 13 years later, as she was giving her last speech to Parliament, this is what part of what she said. This speech was called the Golden Speech. And she said, "And though you have had and may have many mightier and wiser princes sitting in the seat, yet you have never had nor shall have any that will love you better." And the people in the room were transfigured into tears at this event. This is her last speech, and people were on their feet applauding, and it's been called the Golden Speech. And you see what she did. Then let's look to a more modern king, Warren Buffett, and what he says in the shareholder letter. "Agonizing over errors is a mistake, but acknowledging and analyzing them can be useful, though that practice is rare in the corporate boardrooms." So Warren Buffett in his shareholder letters, if you ever looked at it, one of the things he always talks about right up front is he admits a mistake he's made. And I love this story. Warren Buffett, "Dear shareholder, I am so sorry." And as people meet, they love that about him because they feel the honesty that he just right up front with what he hasn't done. He hasn't done well. People believe when he talks about what he has done, what he has done well. So this has led in some case to our philosophy of a program that some of you have, we're actually at the very beginning of, probably about 7 years ago, first time I started to introduce it at a board meeting for Don and Judy. So this is about the power of credibility, and it is the science behind our philosophy. And this is how we look at it. It's become one of our great looks and bases with how we do things. So we do this, we acknowledge and accept there are going to be impacts of what we're doing. Contrast the impacts of acting with a greater impact of not acting. We embrace the overall benefits of natural gas. We bridge value, our value-based message, to create an economic message. And the thing is, if you look at it, we're going to switch these in a minute, and you can see what that becomes. Most of us start with the economics. And most people are going to stay with us and are excited about what we're doing because of the economic, but that's not why they're going to support who we are and what we are. So the acknowledge, pretty straightforward. We acknowledge there are going to be some impacts and things are going to be happening. So I'm going to play a little video about vaccinations. So one of the big things, if you think about the pharmaceutical industry, I mean, they're the classic, constantly always telling us what the acknowledging the downside. So let's play this quickly. We're trying to fix this, folks. So I understand you didn't hear that. So what this was is Penn and Teller talking about the vaccinations, that what worked, what didn't. And of course, you know, with vaccinations, there have been some issues and what happens with those issues, but what happens if we didn't have the vaccination? So one, they acknowledge that there's a problem. And two, they contrast immediately with what would have happened if they didn't have the vaccination. So acknowledge is about sharing the cons before the pros, and that builds credibility. The first time I tried this, it was a while ago when we were doing candidate campaigns, and I was working with a candidate for state office in California, which is a big deal. I did not want to do it all on my own. I was going to be the chair of the committee rather than the consultant. So I was out to hire the consultant, and the candidate wanted me to do it. So I had to bring some folks in. So I lined up the one I really wanted. I talked about why we shouldn't hire them. And then I talked about why we should hire them. And it was like magic. It's like, oh, okay. It builds credibility and makes it work better. So this is one of my favorite examples. And it came from a great textbook, and it was a letter. It was like a 2-page letter, and I've been able to take it down to a sentence, which illustrates something really great in our world today, is how much we can get things across simply. So letter, if you notice, to Reverend and Victoria Lewis. The subject is Christmas. Dear Mom and Dad, sure hope you're well. I miss you. Sadly, I won't be coming home for Christmas. I'm leaving for Nepal tomorrow. The thing is, I'm pregnant, and my boyfriend is from Nepal. We are going to meet his parents. They live close to the Himalaya Mountains. You're often taught tolerance and love for others will mean you will accept him as a Buddhist and me as a convert. Love you both, Jenny. P.S. Now that she's got her parents' attention, a little P.S., a little lower. I'm not pregnant. I don't have a boyfriend. I'm not converting or moving to Nepal. but I did not do very well in my first semester of college. I failed calculus and world history and got C's in the other classes. And I wanted you to see those grades with a better perspective. One would not get away with this more than once. So it's sort of smuggling an influence principle into something, but it sure makes the point and makes it clear. So that's acknowledge and that's contrast. That's what it looks like. But what happens when we do these, and those are the two most important, because the embrace, we're all good at. We're really good at embracing all the good things we're doing. We're all really good at talking about the economics. But what we really end up doing is just the opposite. What we do is we turn it into something else. The bridge is really a promise. The embrace is a spin. The contrast is a complain. And the acknowledge is a confess. And what happens then is we constantly lose support. We promise jobs and economic impacts right off the start. We spin the concepts of the projects with only benefits. And then we complain how unfair it is that people are protesting. Then we admit, finally, that there are some impacts. And that's a confess. And what happens is support drops and drops and drops and drops rather than doing it the other way. And we don't want to do that. So let's look at the third, the power of others. So we find what we can do and how to do things, what's appropriate for us to do, believe, feel, or even take action to the extent that others believe that, what they are doing, how they feel, what they're doing. And as a rule, it almost always proves out to be right. When a lot of people are doing something, it proves to be right. I think John Lennon said it so well, like many of the things he said, you may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I mean, that's the power of others. So this gentleman was one of the leaders of the Arab Spring in Egypt, and he was an accidental activist. So Waleed Gohom tapped into the shared frustration that became immediately evident online. 2 minutes after he started a Facebook page, just because he was frustrated, and it said, we're all Khalid Ziad. 300 people had joined in 2 minutes. 3 months later, that number had grown to 250,000 people. What bubbled up online with people like him and really circled around him spilled into the streets. And it started with those silent stands and then went to the massive historic rally at Tahrir Square in downtown Cairo. And what happened then is that's how Mubarak ended up resigning, the dissolution, the end of the National Democratic Party. And this gentleman was arrested numerous times, held in prison, and he reluctantly became one of the leading voices of the Arab Spring. And the idea of what he said, the power of the people is greater than the people in power. And so what drives this is the validity and feasibility drives the power of others. So let me unpack that a little bit. We find an action more valid when we see evidence of the frequency of the action. It elevates our judgments to the right correctness. So we're able to jump and do things. So it elevates our judgments to act when we see evidence of more people doing it. And then we consider completing an action as feasible. So can we get something started, but can I really finish it? Which is a big thing right now in our society. We're gonna get it done. And we're more likely to do it when we see others doing it, especially others that are like us completing the task successfully. Here in Southern California, we had, with the drought, we had this crazy drought, but what happened is everyone had to join in. So it became a deal, people put up lawn signs, gold is the new green. This made national publication. This gold is the new green campaign makes the national news because it really worked. People let their lawns go and they're willing to do it and cut back on water. We can talk about whether that was a good idea, but it worked. And the thing is, the more people you get to act on your behalf, the more people you will get to act on your behalf. And what you need to look at are three things. The people are similar. They have to be people that they relate to, that there are a lot of people in the situation is unfamiliar. So last two, I'm gonna go through pretty quickly. So the power of the medium is how we communicate. You think about how we communicate today. If you look at this, medium is a message, Marshall McLuhan. And the book, the first title of the book that was published was A Medium is a Massage. There was a typo. But Marshall McLuhan said, hey, it actually is true. The medium massages the message, and we should keep it that way. We should talk about it that way. Throughout history, all these innovations, communications, both taken away and given, every new thing has a dark side to it. Everything has a shadow. I mean, think about digital, how much is provided faster, but it reverses on us. We're making decisions too fast. He tried to warn us. He said, we need to master these. We need to see what a device can do and what they can undo. And, you know, we always hear that the media or devices are just tools. They're neither good or bad, sort of like the plumbing in a home. That logic is pretty straightforward. Unfortunately, it's not true, because a medium is the message. It's true that our methods or mediums change. So does the message. We cannot change mediums without changing the message. So Marshall McLuhan in his book gets a little carried away when he talks about the content of a message of any particular medium has about as much importance as a stenciling on the casing of an atomic bomb. A little carried away. In other words, the various media through which we acquire information are not neutral. They have the power to shape us in the world, regardless of the content. And so the last one is the power of attention. And earning people's attention is what our goal is. So a communicator who gets an audience to focus on a key element of a message loads that with extra importance. So that's what we need to be able to do. We need to load that with more message. And it's called priming. There's a whole bunch of examples of what it is, how we build that up. But that's part of the game. And so how does attention work? There's different types of attention currency. And we're going to look at these three groups really quickly. Our goal is to maximize the attention. So we have front of mind and back of mind. So front of mind and back of mind, quickest thing I can say is the first day of skiing every year, I'm skiing with the front of my mind because I can't remember what to do. My muscle memory takes a day to get into it. Day three, I'm skiing 100% back of mind. And I think we all do that. We drive home from work sometimes, and we drive home back of mind, where it was like, I don't remember driving home. I was thinking, I was talking, we're able to go through it. Then the other peer is attraction and aversion. Think about something that's scary. Someone running down the street with a gun, someone with a knife, someone scaring you in the neighborhood. That has your attention very much so. And something that you're really attracted to, something you want, something you really would love to have, something you admire, that captures our attention. The next one is voluntary and captive. So captive is going to traffic school when you get a speeding ticket. Voluntary is going to a great movie, going to a great dinner, going someplace that you really want to be. So how do we earn attention? We all know there's lots of things swirling around us, and we have to decide, what will I pay attention to? And so we get people to pay attention. There's a narrowing phase to pay attention to. Okay, so I got it. I get it. Well, okay. Now what should I do? Then there's a decision phase. Will I take action? That's our goal. We have to understand we got to earn awareness. We got to earn attention. And then we got to get people to take action. We can't do it as one simple step. I have no idea who this man is, but I just want to say that I think it's a great quote. They may not tell you what to think, but what to think about. And that's what's happening so much in our society right now at this time is what's happening. And I have a few slide to end with about social media and the influencers and comparing it to the old Wheaties, but I'm going to end now and take some questions. Thank you.
I need to take myself off mute there. Thank you, John. Are there any questions? If you have a question for John, please type it in the chat section there. John, I think if you have a couple more slides on social media, I don't have any questions yet. So I think,
okay, well, I'll look at these. I just popped it on. So if you remember the era of endorsements, meaning it was the superstars on the Wheaties box, and so that was a big deal. I'm being coached right now.
Okay. Remember, use the chat function down here at the bottom of your Zoom app to type in any questions you might have for John. You're back up, John, it looks like. Yeah, there we are.
Yes. So, I know, right? I mean, how great is that? So we have Gale Sears. So, I mean, in that era, that, you know, that's what it was. You get your taste on a box. So now the newest thing that built up and is still there but slowly fading is influencers. So the stat that's known with influencers is very similar to what we want to do with getting leaders in a community to stand up and say good things about you. And there's people that already like you. There's people that already have respect. So we found that people will be only 7% less to follow an influencer than they are a really good friend. So when you're a good friend, people are 60% likely to follow what a good friend tells them to do, like go to this restaurant, buy this clothes, go try these shoes. And they're 49% likely to follow an influencer. I mean, so a good friend, someone you know and trust, a social influencer is just 7% below. And that's the same in everything that we do, that we need to get people to do that. And so we go from this to this. We go to this situation where, you know, we have these folks that, I mean, make millions. We have I have a friend whose company paid two of the Kardashians $500,000 to go into their store on Fifth Avenue in New York City for 20 minutes. They went in, they took pictures, they walked around, they gave them the bags, they walked up Fifth Avenue, and their driver picked them up half hour into the game for $500,000, and they went to the airport and flew home. That's a game changer. But what's happening is people are starting to evaluate this a little bit. Are they like me? We just talked about. Do they share my values? Are they someone I can trust? And so it's changing slowly and slowly. My daughter had an internship in a social influencer firm with their entire job is to manage social influencers and be able to do it. But it's going to lose a little steam because people know they're making money on it. So that's a game changed. So their reign may be over because they lose the authenticity that they need to have. So my ending is theory, action. I mean, we're an industry right now where I can see massive changes coming in numerous states, especially on the West Coast. And we need to be taking action. We need to be jumping and doing things and taking care of it. And I don't know why Pablo Picasso was saying this, but it is such a true statement. And you're going to believe it more because what his life was like, because he's an influencer to us now. Action is the fundamental key to all success. And that's definitely the game.
Thanks, John.
So that's a quick introduction. Yeah, go ahead. I'm going to try to get rid of my screen.
Yeah, first of all, I'll say that the picture you had up there was not Walter Payton. It was, I'm sorry, it wasn't Gale Sayers. It was Walter Payton. My mistake. Anyway, I do have a question here, prefaced by a comment. Bought a box of Wheaties with Jordan Spieth on the cover, and he hasn't won a match since. How do you counter the phenomena of if you tell the big lie often enough, people will begin to believe it? If you're being straight up front, that is all some will hear, and they'll run with it and not hear the positives. So how do you embrace that?
That's the enigma. So just telling, fighting the big lie, and you know we have a bunch of those. The fight with the natural gas industry is when you're, it's just you versus those who are attacking you and saying whatever they want, because we can't lie. We need to have third parties, and that's the power of others. That comes from the power of connection. That we need to make connections with those. Most of them are already on our side, and then we need the power of others speaking out, other people speaking out on our behalf. And the challenge is, I mean, we got to watch this right now, because will they speak out on our behalf now as things get harder and harder? So we need to be very careful that we don't let that turn on us. Does that make sense? Whoever asked that question.
I think it does. I'll give you one last call, people, for another question for John. We'll just have a beat of silence while you're typing. We'll give it about 10 seconds here, John.
Okay. No. Oh, no problem. No, I know it's one of the crazy things about Zoom, and you're in the chat room and they're about to end the question and you're halfway through your thought.
Right. Well, okay, John, I think I want to thank you for a terrific presentation and certainly thought-provoking, the notion of sort of reversing the order of how we respond to things. There is a very timely and relevant example I would give just today. So in this week, I believe, Earth Justice and the Sierra Club released a report that they authored on renewable natural gas. And it's entitled Myth Versus Reality. And the effect, the conclusion is renewable natural gas is a myth and we just need to move beyond the whole gas system thing. I asked the Renewable Natural Gas Coalition whether they had seen it and how they responded to it. And their response was absolutely brilliant, I thought, because they did respond to it. There's a press release. If anybody's interested in seeing either the report or the press release, please email me. I'll be happy to send them off to you. But they were not one bit defensive in their response. In effect, they said, we welcome the fact that the Sierra Club and Earth Justice are elevating this issue to a discussion, to a national discussion. We welcome it and we trust that science and goodwill will win out in the end. I mean, it was brilliant.
That's great. I will tell you, recent research that we've done have been very interesting. Some serious changes. One of the things is a 15-20 second description of renewable natural gas had people giddy on the research about how great it was. It's something that you can get people to understand quickly and they get really excited. And the other thing that from recent research that I think I share since we're talking about it is the acceptance of natural gas has gone from just it's essential and it's a must have to something that's accepted and it's better than other things. It's not perfect, it's better. So there is a change happening here that we need to watch. And the numbers are still good, it's still something people get in favor of most places, but it's starting to change to be evaluated and contrasted with other things. It used to be contrasted with coal. Now it's being contrasted with renewables. But renewable natural gas is a game changer.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you, John, one more time.
Thank you.
Time today. For the listeners still on the call here, I just want to remind you of our September 17th webinar featuring FortisBC talking about carbon pathways to a clean 2050. So with that, we'll release you for the remainder of the day. Remember that we've recorded this webinar, and so you'll see it on our NWGA YouTube channel. If you want the slides, John J. Davies at daviespublicaffairs.com. Send him an email and he'll send you the deck. And with that, one last time, John, big thanks. We appreciate your
thank
time.
You. Thank and you. Everybody. Always great to be with you and your group.
Yeah. Everybody, we hope you have a great day. Thank you.